And now it's time for
Great Moments in History.
And today, many moons ago, in fact, 22 moons ago, British Rail stopped using steam trains, and everyone went, "Aw, oh, shy my."
I caught up with Kenny Everett, not at Capital Radio, but in the studio he has had built in his London flat. I first reminded him of one of the great loves he talked about in that unruly interview back in 1980.
And I love going to Safeways. I love supermarkets. I love supermarkets. It's like Aladdin's cave. I just walk along with me, you know, the trolley, stick my arm out behind the tins, and go... walk out. Oh, oh God! Oh, cut! Cut! We'll try that one again. Walk out with 200 tins of ambrosia creamed rice.
You see, Kenny Everett, nine years ago, we did that last program.
Wasn't I funny in those days, Mavis?
You're still funny,
it's
Kenny
all finished
Everett.
Now.
But you know, I want to ask you, are you still as keen on supermarkets? You obviously really loved them then.
I love them now. They're Aladdin's cave. I adore supermarkets. It comes from not being able to eat in Liverpool when I was a child. We had ration books. And it was like my mother used to say, she'd buy a piece of fruit and put it on top of the telly, which is exactly the place not to put your fruit. She'd put it like three bits of old orange and a banana, and she'd stand back and look at it and go, ooh, and rearrange it from time to time. And she'd say, as I went to take one, she'd go, ooh, no, leave it, and it'll still be there tomorrow. So now I adore supermarkets because you can run in there. And groceries are quite cheap, actually. Compared to a West End meal for three, which is about 100 and something, outrageous. £100 worth of supermarket gunge, I mean, it could last you a month.
Not if you've got a family, Kenny Everett. I don't think many people would think it was cheap to buy food in Britain today.
Okay,
Take it all back. But, you know, if you go to a supermarket, aren't you recognised then?
Oh, yes, yeah. I think that's why I'm rather fast with the trolley. I've become a trolley expert.
Look, you're shy, really, right?
Yes.
Right. So do you like your fame, or is fame the last thing you almost wanted?
No, I hate it. I made the great mistake of, when I was very young, of thinking it was a great idea to be famous. And it's not. The people who have the best deal are writers, because they have all the money and the feeling of satisfaction over having created something artistic. And they don't get bothered in the street, you know? I mean, who knows what Hammond Inns looks like except Mrs. Hammond Inns. But when I've got a hangover, which is most of the time, and I'm walking down the street thinking, oh, God, take me now, there's usually some lemon comes out and goes, oh, look, you're him, aren't you? You're him. Here, Doris, it's him. And they hold on to you while they've got you, you know. So, bring the kids. And you're standing there, you're cracking visibly.
You'd miss it.
I'd miss the fame.
Would you miss the fame?
No, I don't think so.
Do you miss your shows? Because rumour has it that you're not going to do any more shows on TV. Is that true?
Yes, that's true.
Why?
Yes, because the makeup and the lights and, you know... And if you earn a lot of money, you tend to attract people who come to you and say, hello, my old chum. You know I've always adored you. Let's go to Bermuda. You're paying. That sort of thing happens. So you can only eat one meal at a time, so I've decided to be medium rich and just stick to radio.
That's what you're really going to do?
Radio is God. I love radio because you can communicate easier. You don't have to wear makeup and... Well, you wear less makeup, let's say. For radio. You wear even less makeup for medium wave. It's fab.
But you know, you've also got another thing about radio, I think, which must suit you, being shy. And that is that you are there on your own. There's nobody else. It's you to the world. You can say
anything you like.
There's a million maybe listening, but you're there. You are like a writer in a sense.
Yeah.
Whereas telly is sort of surrounding you with people.
There's one guy who does radio on TV, and that's John Sessions. Because he's managed somehow to completely block out the fact that there are 60 people in the audience and 10 million more out there. He just rambles like a happy idiot, just gushing his genius into the camera. I can't help but imagine when I'm standing in a TV studio that there are people watching. And on a good day, it's great. I have John Sessions attacks where I just gush and it's great, but that mood isn't always there. You know, some days you think, oh, God, take me away.
You're the classic, aren't you? You've said twice now, God, take me away.
Yes, it's my ambition to go to heaven. My mother said it was a really great place.
How do you think you've changed in the last 9 years?
I've got more slow, I think.
Slow?
Yeah. Well, that clip you played at the start of the show, I was surprised now. I looked at it and thought, my God, he's fast. We must sign him up, whoever he is. I thought, oh, my God, it's me. Did I have that much hair? So...
Do you think you made a mistake by sort of announcing to the papers that you'd come out?
A mistake? Not really, because it got it over with, I suppose. Because in those days, if you said, as I did, oh, by the way, folks, because they asked me, yes, I'm gay, they went, oh, Kenny Everett is a screaming fag! And that got it over with. Whereas now, if the News of the World want to go to town on you, they have to, I mean, being gay is nothing now. It has to be, he nails choir boys to the roof sort of thing. You know, they've got to really go to town nowadays. And I'm old news now, so they finished with me. They had a go at me, and now they've finished and gone on to some other poor, unfortunate creature.
Did you find, to your horror, that people were nastier than you expected about it? I mean, like a lot of blacks say, that people hurl abuse at them.
Yeah. Well, my masseur, I have this guy, straight, who comes in once every 2 weeks and rearranges all my bones. And he said to me, he said, now you know what it's like being black. Because he's black. And people hurl abuse at him in the street just because he's black.
How did they hurl abuse at you?
Well, there were... There were two little incidents, one of which I've forgotten, and the other some building worker was dangling off the scaffolding the day after the articles appeared. And they were shouting all sorts of horrible things, and he got his trousers off and waved his willy into the street. I don't know what effect he thought it was going to have on me. Maybe he thought I would faint with delight.
Have you actually... been annoyed or hurt or what about it, though? By your newspaper coverage, say?
No, that was just startling. It's startling to see your name on the front page of the Daily Mirror that high. It's very startling.
Do you think they treated you badly, roughly?
Oh, yeah, they were deeply inaccurate about most things to do with it. And they, like, took out the reasonable bits and... made the unreasonable, outrageous bits more huge. So in the end, it looks like you're some kind of raging, demented creature. Well, I'm not just an ordinary...
chap who goes around his business.
Ordinary chap who used to be a priest for 10 minutes.
Priest? When?
I was a priest for a year. I was in the St. Peter Claver Stillington Junior Missionary Brigade... practicing to be a priest. In nomine Patris et Filii Spiritui Sancti, Maeve.
Right.
You are now forgiven.
But do you mean then in that case that you, what did you do? Decide no, not for me?
No, they decided not for them. Well. Because I had all sorts of funny little ways, like I used to steal stationery because I was a prodigious drawer. You know, there's nothing to draw on. So I used to steal stationery. And other things. And not steal other things, but did all the other naughty, schoolboyish things. Like we used to burrow our way down into the cellars and steal altar wine. We were only about 13 years old. It seemed too good to miss. But apparently that's a heinous crime. And what I didn't realise is the people I was confessing to owned the place. You know? The guys that took my confession actually owned the place. So I was really scuppering myself.
So are you still religious?
Only in my own funny little way. I deeply believe that there is somebody up there that's going to scoop me up after all this is over.
And take you into loving arms into heaven.
Something like that, maybe.
Something like that, right. Ages ago, like 9 years ago, you used to live in Wales. Why did you leave? Were you irritated by us?
Or what? I wasn't the Welsh people, because they're only about one every square mile. They're quite rare. People in Wales. It was just the circumstances. I went from a country house in Sussex, which was manicured. Sussex is manicured, you know, it's all, every inch is taken. and they cut the grass with designer scissors, and all the cows are shampooed every day. And I suddenly went from that thinking, hey, let's get even more away from it all and get our fingers dirty. So we decided to buy this place on a mountaintop in Llandovery, which is right in the middle of Wales near the Brecon Beacons. And that's rough.
Beautiful, though.
Oh, it's beautiful from a
plane. Oh, yes.
Yes, it's beautiful in a photograph, but it's freezing, and it rains most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning and milk cows. And they're buggers. Oh, the rear end of a cow is not a pretty place. I mean, to look at or to be near. And you have to wipe your hands in Udsal, which is a kind of antiseptic sort of gungy stuff before you start milking. And you have to trim your nails and everything. And this cow, who is not interested at all in being milked, you know, it considers you an irritation. You have to clamp onto this thing, and it moves around, being dragged all over. And then you've got to go... for about an hour with this beast not wanting to know, and you squirt away into this bucket, and you just get the bucket full after about an hour because it comes out in very thin little mean little squirts. By the time you got about a bucket full of a gallon or something, it suddenly lifts one of its legs and splat, and it bounces into the pail, turns into chocolate milkshake, and you have to put it in through the other end.
I know,
to refeed it.
I live in Wales and I don't milk cows. You didn't have to milk cows. You're not meant to be milking cows,
are you?
Oh, you
know, in showbiz, Maeve, you got to go for it.
How did you get on with the people?
The people were great. No teeth. Not one tooth between them. Well, I mean, mountain folk. But they're very generous, because once I had a studio rather like this, but in a cow shed. And the cows underneath, and I had to stop recording every time one of them decided to have a sing-song. But apart from that, it was okay. The steam used to come up through the floorboards. But it was quite nice, except one day, one of the valves in my tape machines, that was the valve days, went ping, and I needed to do a show to send off Swansea Railway to the BBC, because it was on the next day. I thought, I've got to do this recording. So I sent for a technician who came up from London, Express, and he went, it's an A219/V that you need. You can get those in the backs of televisions. So we climbed into the Land Rover, drove about 2 miles to the next farm, and said, you've got something in the back of your TV I need. Can I borrow it overnight? And he went, yes. Yeah, Doris, show him into the back of the TV. So we delved into them. Fortunately, there was nothing on that night. We pulled out one of these valves, went back, recorded the show, and took it back the next day. They're so kind. That was very sweet.
So how do you think England has changed over the last 9 years?
Last 9 years? Well, I didn't used to notice, but London done off smell of car fumes. Maybe I'm getting more delicate as I get older, but I really think it smells now. When I first came here, maybe I was just young and stupid, I didn't notice I was too busy being busy. But, when you put your head out the window, wallop, and it's noisier, it's dirtier, and I'm getting out. I'm selling all this as fast as possible. I'm
going to
move to Wiltshire. It's the last county near London that hasn't been nargled.
But I thought you might have liked England in the last 9 years. I'll just show you a little bit from the previous programme.
Let's go the whole hog.
You are an anarchist, then. Yeah, you are an anarchist.
No, I voted conservative. I did. I love that Maggie Thatcher. Her and her stainless steel hair. She's one. Have you noticed it never moves?
since that piece, you verified that in Brighton at the Conservative conference.
That's right.
Did you get any stick for that afterwards?
Stick? Did I get stick? Yes, well, let me tell you the background to that. You know Michael Winner, the movie director? Mm. Well, he sort of became a not a father figure, but he used to pat me on the head and say, you should do this and you should do that. Wonderful, wonderful, flamboyant Jewish director. And one day he rang me up and said, can I? There's a Conservative Party conference going on and I think you should be a part of it because, it's going to be on television and everything. Come around for a meal. So I went around for a meal and in his luxurious pad. And he said, "Right, do you want to do this thing?" And I said, "Well, have they asked me to do it?" He said, "Yes." I said, "Well, all right, is it going to be fun?" Because I didn't know anything about politics, and I still don't. All I know is that it's just like the... It's like one bunch of bastards who alternate with another bunch of bastards, and they take it in turns to scoop huge amounts of tax off us, and they've all got houses in Bermuda.
No, they haven't all got...
Well, have you seen Geoffrey Howe's house?
No.
Four.
What, in Bermuda?
Mavis? That's a house and a half. No, not in Bermuda, in England. He's got a house to knock your drawers off. And he's not even the Prime Minister. Eddie rode up. Michael said, "You've got to say something outrageous, Kenny, because you'll be on stage and it'll probably be on the news." So I thought, oh, my God, what? Something like, "Let's bomb Russia." Went, "Perfect!" "I can't say that, Michael. It's outrageous." "You're in the business of outrageous, Monsieur." So I went on stage and said this fairly innocuous, I thought, statement. Because, I mean, we couldn't bomb Russia if we tried, because we've got one wooden rocket and the rubber band's bust anyway.
Well, what are we spending our money on if it's one wooden rocket?
Geoffrey Howe's house. So I said this and thought nothing of it, and we drove off after having a couple of curly sandwiches. And the next thing I know, I'm on news at 5:45 or whatever it was.
You did say bomb Russia.
Oh, yeah.
And you did say kick away Michael Foot's stick or something.
Yes, wasn't that awful?
That was
awful. I don't
know
what came over me. It's dreadful.
Are you a manic or a depressive, or are you a manic depressive?
Oh, golly. Oh,
all comedians are supposed to be manic depressives. Haven't you read that?
Yes, I've read it. Yeah, I have violent reversages of mood. Yeah. But I suppose being up one minute and down the next is better than just being around the middle forever. Do you think?
I think so. But not as depressed as you got once when you actually... Did you not? Did you not?
Yes, I did. Yeah,
what?
Yeah. Isn't that silly? I felt such a fool.
You tried to kill yourself?
I was very depressed, though, at the
time.
Because, yeah, the figures came out for the show and on the radio show, and they were terribly low because nobody knew Capital existed. It was in the early days. And I thought, ugh, nobody loves me, I can't go on. So I decided to take a lot of pills, because it was the sleeping pill era. Oh, it was the pill era. It was the 60s or something. And I had these wonderful things called mandrax that made you feel great for about 20 minutes, and then you'd fall over into bed. And I took about loads of these things. And before I knew it, I was making the mistake that all cries for help make, which is I phoned somebody to say goodbye.
You did?
Yeah.
Who did you phone?
I phoned Aidan Day, the director of Capital, to say sorry about the figures, Aid. So he came round with several ambulances and dragged me away. And the awful thing was...
Were you aware of it?
Aware of what?
Were you unconscious by that time, or not? Or were you still compos mentis sort of thing?
When what happened?
When they got the ambulances.
Oh, no, I was gone.
You're gone?
Yeah, I was...
It was serious then, wasn't it?
There.
Serious?
I don't know whether serious.
Well, how did Lee take it then, your wife then?
She just thought I was a silly bugger.
Mm.
And upon reflection, she's absolutely right, of course. Because when I woke up, I thought, great, I've made it. Because I saw these white, fluffy shapes around the bed. I thought, oh, great, angels. Mother was right. But when I came back into focus, of course, they were very annoyed nurses. Because there were people dying, you know, and road accidents everywhere. And I thought, oh, God, I'm in here because I was worried about something as trivial as radio figures. And the awful thing was, 10 minutes later, the figures were up, you know, because they go up and down figures.
Did you have a sense of relief or indignation when you found yourself alive?
Oh, I was very annoyed because I felt like a prat, you know.
What did you...
Putting these people to all this inconvenience.
But, of course, your chatter at the time was... you all ought to try it sometime.
Did I say
yes,
that?
Yes, you did.
Oh, my God.
Not me, Kenny Everett, if you don't
all
mind.
You ought to try suicide. Are you sure I would
you
say something
You said something like that.
You said,
everybody ought to try it once in their life, you said. Look, it's quite a funny line, but I mean...
Good grief.
But you couldn't...
Oh, I take that back, folks.
Yeah. You couldn't, Kenny, you couldn't have actually really just done it because of the radio figures, could you?
Well, I was young and stupid in those days. You do stupid things when you're young. I do stupid things now. But at least they're sensible, stupid things.
Did it take you a long time to get over it? And you had to re-establish that now that you're alive, what are you alive for?
Still trying to figure that out, Maeve. Really. I think maybe, I've seen a lot of movies, you see, so I'm a bit confused. I think maybe I'm here to make people laugh a bit. Because the first time I tried to commit, well, thought about committing suicide was when I first met Lee. She was married to Billy Fury then, and we went down to his place in the country for a rave over the weekend. And I suddenly thought, I'm revolting, I'm full of guts and blood and giblets and things. This is not for me, I want to be back in the arms of God. And she said, if you commit suicide in here, I'll be furious. We just had this carpet put down. Yeah, if you want to be messy, go into the garden and avoid the lawn. So I thought, oh, well, maybe I won't then.
Was it because you were taking drugs you got depressed?
Probably, yes.
Probably, wasn't it?
Yeah. I mean, they're great for about an hour, but when they wear off, it has the opposite effect, you know? You feel great, 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 and then you feel,
But then people take more in order to feel great, 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 great.
Story of life, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's like, hey, let's have Christmas every day. But you die after a week. Voice right. Now we need a script. I've said you're groovy in this.
Oh, lovely.
Is that right?
Brill.
Don't want to contravene the Trades Descriptions Act. And I've put a bit of Welsh in the last line.
Oh, lovely.
Thought you'd like that.
Can you spell it?
Yaki da, it says. Right, here we go. The Mavis is so groovy jingle.
Mavis is so groovy, she is the best by far. She does a darn good interview, so cheers and yakidar.
And cheers and
yakidar
to you. And thank you for letting me catch up with you, Kenny.
Okay, bye.
Bye.
She's sweet.